Well, howdy, everyone. Hello. Are you relaxed? I am. I'll give you a message as soon as I get one. I might just wander around, you know. Oh, hi, Katie. Now, it's okay. Everybody's watching you. You're the object of attention now. You're the object of attention now. Just easy on the chairs, okay?
Easy on the chairs. Okay?
Yeah. Yeah, she's a lightning rod.
She's a lightning rod.
How many of you like to be lightning rods, you know?
How many of you like to be lightning?
You know, everywhere you go, you get struck by lightning.
Yeah, you
would.
Yeah.
Glory. 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 Oh.
Don't you know any of the words?
You know any of the words?
Have a rest.
Have a rest.
How loose do you think Lutherans can get?
How loose do you think Lutherans can get?
What's your faith level?
What's your faith level?
Someone asked, what's smaller than a mustard seed? I said, my faith. Otherwise, I could just move mountains around.
Otherwise, I could just move mountains around.
Oh, dee-dum. What's a good thing to talk about? She's escaping. Hi. Hi. So, how do you feel about Jesus?
I love him.
Yeah. That's no laughing matter. You know, you're. I hope I'm not actually teaching anything new.
I hope I'm not actually teaching anything new.
First thing I learned in theological school was if you think of something that nobody has thought of in 2,000 years, you can be sure you're wrong. But it seems popular these days to just try to come up with, you know, new revelation, new perspectives, new everything no one thought of.
New perspectives, new everything no one thought of.
But we have a faith that was once and for all delivered to the saints.
Jude,
first verse.
First verse.
The trick is to appreciate
the trick
what you already know.
Appreciate trick what you already know.
It's all well and good to believe the right things, but
it's all well and good to believe the right things, but
do you appreciate them?
Do you appreciate them?
There's no limit to how much we can know God, I said this morning, but in the same way, there's no limit to how much you can love Him and be thrilled by Him. That's not funny. And there's no limit to how much you can enjoy Him.
There's no limit to how much you can enjoy Him.
Now we're being distracted, sir.
Now we're being distracted, sir.
Yeah, just, some of you are squirming right now.
Some of you are squirming right now.
You're asking, what place is this do we have for this? Yeah.
Yeah.
Now, I learned in Tibet that prayer wheels only work if you go clockwise. So you're running in the right direction. So,
so you're running in the right direction.
Some of you are covering your faces.
Some of you are covering your faces.
Wondering, where is he going with this? Wondering where is he going.
So am I.
So am I.
Oh, yeah. How many people are jealous of them?
Jealous of them.
How many people are horrified?
Does
anybody want to join them? Just come on up right now.
I'm not sure. Just come on up right now.
She's crawling. She's getting there.
She's crawling.
It's okay. See? Man, that's better than Zacchaeus.
That's better than Zacchaeus.
Hi, so glad you could join us. Hi, what have you come for?
Whatever it is.
Careful now, say lady. Any others hungry? You got three. Do I hear four? Do I hear five? Anybody else? Hi. Oh, it's okay, honey. There's no cure. You wanted renewal. How much renewal do you want?
Not that much.
Not that much.
Oh, hi.
Hi, how are you? Oh, hi. You doing good? How are you over here?
Yeah!
You okay? Hi, sweetie. Don't worry. You're done for. Three, two, one. Don't forget to breathe. What's your problem?
What's your problem?
I love it.
She loves it. Oh well.
She loves it. Oh well.
1 out of 100, not so bad.
1 out of 100, not so bad.
Didum didum nisho chonka renma. So Edgar was talking about the Toronto blessing. What do you think the Toronto blessing was?
What do you think the Toronto blessing was?
Are we going to talk about it? I think Christians, by and large, they desperately need to laugh.
They desperately need to laugh.
You guys desperately need to laugh. Were you turning over? Barry's shaking his head. Okay, calm down, Rolland. Okay. It's not that fun. Don't get so excited. Oh, excuse me. What do you think of all this?
What do you think of all this?
Have any more takers? I dare you. Come up here.
Have any more takers? I dare you. Come up here.
Oh, look, there's more victims. Hi.
Oh, look, there's more victims. Hi.
Oh, hi. Oh, teal that, Lord. Hi. How you doing? You okay?
Yeah.
Where are you going?
Where are you going? Hi, Elizabeth. Are you helping?
We have animals like that in Africa. Oh, look, an innocent bystander. Oh, hi. Oh, I just love her, Jesus. Just love her. He's learning sound doctrine.
He's learning sound doctrine.
It's sound when it makes you happy.
It's sound when it makes you happy.
Could you spell that, please?
Could you spell that, please?
How do you say that in German? Are we having church yet? Where are all the men? Oh, look, I found a man.
Oh, that hurts.
See, who needs aerobics when you have the Holy Spirit? Okay, moving on to point two. Yeah, that's the flesh.
Yeah, that's the flesh.
Okay, all you guys out there, you came to get into the renewal. Are you sure?
You came to get into the renewal. Are you sure?
Maybe you came because you didn't know what the renewal was. Poor guys.
Poor guys.
The ability to appreciate your salvation. When I first went to Toronto, I didn't learn anything new, and I don't remember any of the sermons. But I was there for 3 weeks solid. Up to 3 o'clock in the morning, jumped up at 6 because I didn't want to miss anything. Not one new thing was taught. No new theology. No new explanations. No creeds. No readings. No Heavy books, nothing.
Heavy books, nothing.
I'm trying to make a serious point here.
I'm trying to make a serious point here.
Lutherans believe in the scripture, right?
Lutherans believe in the scripture, right?
What does the scripture say?
What does the scripture say?
Delight yourself in the Lord, and you will get he will give you the desires of your heart. What do you think delighting yourself in the Lord looks like? Now you might say, I do delight in the Lord. I just don't have to act like that.
I just don't have to act like that.
It's not my personality.
It's not my personality.
Do you think God has power?
Do you think God has power?
Do you think he has power to change your personality?
Do you think he has power to change your personality?
And your will, and your heart, and your life, and your body, and your motives, and your everything.
And
you're his workmanship.
You're his workmanship.
It's impossible to underestimate how powerful the Holy Spirit is in giving you the ability to enjoy and appreciate God. You can sit there and say, I already love God. I already know everything. You haven't taught me anything new. Yes, I'm glad I'm saved.
Yes, I'm glad I'm saved.
But the first commandment is, you shall love the Lord your God with all your heart and all your strength, all your soul, all your mind. What does that look like? Meditate on that for a while. What does it mean to love God with everything that's in you?
Everything that's in you.
We don't even come close. In the church. Not even Pentecostals. Yeah, man, I speak in tongues. I've got it all. Are you spirit filled? Yeah, I'm spirit filled.
Yeah, I'm spirit filled.
Is your church in renewal? Yeah, yeah.
Is your church in renewal?
Yeah, yeah.
Is your church in renewal?
Yeah, we tried that, but, you know, we moved on.
Yeah, we tried that, but, you know, we moved on.
Jesus said something else.
Jesus
said unless you become like children,
you
cannot get into the kingdom of God.
Cannot get into the kingdom of God.
That's one of the Lutherans' favorite verses.
One of the Lutherans' favorite verses.
Ever watch children play?
Ever watch children play?
They're not sitting there. What is the ontological substance of my faith?
What is the ontological substance of my faith?
They're just happy. It's a gift of God.
It's a gift of God.
Joy is an absolute gift of God. The ability to enjoy life.
The ability to enjoy life.
When God says, delight yourself in the Lord, that's not a suggestion. That's an injunction.
That's not a suggestion. That's an injunction.
God commands you to enjoy life.
God commands you to enjoy life.
I mean, in the Old Testament, he commanded his people to have feasts.
He commanded his people to have
for
feasts.
For 6 weeks, you will feast and dance and sing, or I'll kill you. And the Holy Spirit makes all that happen.
And the Holy Spirit makes all that happen.
It gives you the ability to treat God the way he wants to be treated. And how does he want to be treated? How would you like to be treated?
How would you like to be treated?
You know, we're made in his image. How would you like to be treated?
How would you like to be treated?
What does love really mean?
What does love really mean?
How do you pick your friends?
How do you pick your friends? How do you pick your friends?
Settle down. I want you to listen here.
Settle down. I want you to listen.
Okay. He's awake.
He's awake.
Yeah. Well, I just get a kick out of the ministry. You came for renewal.
You came for renewal.
What does it look like? What does it mean? Coming alive again. You're enjoying life again. Being happy again. Being free again.
Being free again.
I mean free. Free.
Free.
Where are you supposed to be free in your regular daily
life?
Where
are you supposed to be free?
You know, to really explode and express what's inside you.
Explode and express what's inside you.
Well, first you have to have something inside you. But where would it be? Are you free? Where do you really let loose? In the shower?
Where do you really let loose? In the shower?
You can't do it at work. You can't do it in the classroom. You can't do it,
you
know,
in
public. Certainly can't do it in church. Certainly not in a restaurant, you know.
Certainly not in a restaurant, you know.
So where can you be free?
So where can you be free?
Just let yourself go. Worship
go.
Is a whole lot more than standing, you know, singing something that's. Somebody wrote for you. Worship is your whole life. It's your whole life. Just loving God with everything that's within you and just enjoying everything. And just but what people want is freedom. Freedom to dance and run and sing and shout and think and ask and express and glorify and praise and meditate and be. But just free. Free. But the church has a huge controlling issue. Unbelievable controlling issue. I think everybody should just do it this way and be this way and then you're done. Right? Do you feel a longing for absolute freedom?
You
know,
it's
you can just. You ever been so happy you don't know what to do with yourself?
So happy you don't know what to do with yourself?
No. What on earth are you talking about?
No.
Would you like to be so filled, so thrilled that you don't know what to do with yourself? It's okay. You can.
It's okay. You can.
So renewal means.
So renewal
breaking free of boxes and shackles and feeling things you never felt before and appreciating God in ways you never appreciated Him before. Now some of you are processing. You're just sitting there giving it lots of thought. How do you want to be treated? Love your neighbor as you would have them love you. You know, you can serve somebody. But that doesn't mean you're interested in them. You can give things to people, but that doesn't mean you're interested in them. You can go out in the streets and feed the poor and the hungry. That doesn't mean you're interested in them, necessarily. Your wife can do good things for you. She can bring you gifts. She can cook you dinner. She can just take care of you. She can. That doesn't mean she's interested in you. In the same way, we come to God for all sorts of things. We want to get our beliefs correct. We want to make sure we get to heaven. We want to make sure we're forgiven, et cetera, et cetera. And we have a lot of needs and problems and crises and desires in life. And so we come to Him for those. And that's good. Better than going to, you know, an idol. That doesn't mean we're interested in Him. We just want to get things from Him. We just want Him to bless us. We heard He loves us, so we want to be loved, you know, by stuff. But to be interested in somebody, that's something different. When you're interested in somebody, you want to be with them. Not a discipline. I really don't like titles like the discipline of prayer. Somebody finding it to be disciplined to talk to me. How does that make me feel? Falling in love is not a discipline. When you're interested in somebody, your favorite time is to be with them. And it's no effort at all to talk to them. And to find out, what they're like. What makes them tick? What's inside? What are they thinking? How do they feel? What can they do? What's inside them? What are they made out of? Huge difference. Between believing in God and serving Him, even being a missionary, even being a pastor, so many pastors say, "I don't have time to pray. I have a big church." Well, you're far more interested in your big church than you are in God. Suppose you're a missionary. You go to school of missions. And you're very interested in missions. That's not the same as being interested in God. You may like interfaith dialogue. That's not the same as being interested in God. I can always tell what people are interested in simply by what they talk about. Very simple. You go to lunch, when you go out, when you especially when you get out of church. Now what do you talk about? Heidi and I were on the staff of the biggest church in Hawaii once for a year, First Assembly of God, Honolulu, Pentecostal. Because it was in the middle of the Pacific, we had lots of famous speakers coming across and stopping in Honolulu. They were always our guest speakers on Sunday night. The pastors always spoke Sunday morning, three, four services. And Heidi and I were given the job of taking them out to dinner after the service. And we would be so excited to find a man of God, famous around the world, be able to have dinner with him. Because then we would get interested in talking about God with somebody that really knew him. What happened? Most of the time they would say, look, I'm done now. I'm off now. The sermon's over. I want downtime. I just want to relax. I just want to be me. I'm not on now. I'm off now. So let's talk about something else. Worship teams do that. Some of the best well-known worship teams in America, they tell me, look, you know, when I'm not leading worship, when we're off, finish our set, we leave. We head for a bar. We get our poker cards and our liquor and our cigars, and we just relax, and we just find out who our friends are and just be real. It's very simple to tell what somebody's relationship with God is like just by what they want to talk about when they're free. I think most of the time, people are far more interested in finding out how they can get God to facilitate their dreams. They could care less about what God wants to do. They're afraid of what God wants to do. They're suspicious of what God wants to do. They're nervous about what God wants to do. But they want the ability to get God's will to match theirs. And so we have this whole trend toward open theism and the idea that God's in charge, but he's not in control. He's left us in control. We don't really care about how God feels. We're told we're amazing. God respects our will. He respects our desires. He's such a good God that he bends over backwards to accommodate us. But if you're interested in God, you care what he thinks. You care how he feels. And I found out in the Indonesian revival that faith is not some power that you have to get God's power working for you. Real faith is knowing what God wants to do in a given situation. It's like Jesus said, if my words abide in you and you abide in me and you ask according to the will of God, it's done. I'll do anything you say. That's real revival. Real revival is being so united to God, you don't have a will of your own, and everything you pray for gets answered. That's not going to happen until you're interested enough in him to care about what he thinks, what he feels. So I was talking about this morning, getting to know God is your only real job in life. But that requires interest. You're not going to want to spend time with somebody you don't enjoy and you're not interested in, which is how most people in church treat God. They come and they worship for a while and they sing their songs properly and they leave and then they something else. But what does loving God with your whole heart, all your heart, mind, soul, and strength look like? That's what renewal really is. It's not just certain phenomena. It's not just certain gifts. It's being so interested in God, you don't care about your own will anymore. You want to know him. You want to know what's good. You want to understand how God thinks. And you want to think along with him. You want that perfect fellowship. Perfect fellowship doesn't happen when you're always contending with God and trying to change his will. Perfect fellowship happens when you delight to do his will. But how are you going to delight to do his will if you don't know him, if you're not interested in him? So... Oh, just get it over. Just get free. So, it's not about putting in your time at church, you know. It's what happens when you get home. What happens between conferences? What happens on Monday morning when you wake up? What happens when your friends are not around? If you really love somebody, your favorite time is to be alone with that person. You don't have to feel like you have to put in an hour of prayer a day, you know, to make it, or 4 hours. I mean, there's ministries where the pastors are proud of the fact that they spend 4, 5, 7 hours a day in prayer. Well, my question is, what are you doing the rest of the time? God says, Paul says, pray without ceasing. You should be connected all the time. You should be so interested in God, you're never disconnected. I can talk about tennis and science and all kinds of things for a while. Talk about most anything. I have a broad education for a while, but not for very long. There's only one favorite subject, and that's our God. That's our favorite subject. That's what we want to talk about all the time. It's he's who we're really interested in, far more than politics and business and everything else going on in this world. Oh, look, I have notes. Let's talk about something fun. Hell. What do you think? Is that a good subject? There is one, you know. Well, the thing is, if you're trying to build your church and you're trying to be popular and you're trying to be success and you're trying to encourage people, you don't want to scare them. You really don't. But it wasn't Jesus' approach. I have this theory that everything in the Bible is there for a reason. God put every sentence in there for a reason. And I always tell people, read a whole Bible. Old and New Testament, preferably both every day. Read away, have a plan, and do it spontaneously, both, you know, just whatever, just get it all, get everything, don't miss anything. Nowadays, it is not popular at all in almost any church. In fact, it's been years in the Renewal when I've heard anybody preach about hell. At all. The usual attitude is we can't get our heads around it, so we're just not going to talk about it. It's getting exceedingly quiet in here. Yeah. Okay, I have two believers here. Two believers here.
This is hilarious. If you get people drunk enough, you can teach them anything. Never mind. Jesus says, I say to you that everyone who is angry with his brother shall be guilty before the court, and whoever says to his brother, you fool, good for nothing, shall be guilty before the Supreme Court, and whoever says, yeah, you fool, shall be guilty enough to go into the fiery hell. Okay. Is anybody here guilty enough to go into the fiery hell? Have you ever called anyone, something less than complimentary? That's all it takes. That's just how perfect God is. You look down on somebody, you think you're better than they are, you're critical in any way, judgmental in any way. That's it. You're in danger of the fire of hell just by just that. Sin, the Greek word hamartia, simply means missing the mark. And if you miss the mark at all, you're guilty and in danger of hell. Jesus said that. He was as strict in the New Testament as God ever was in the Old Testament. If your right eye makes you stumble, tear it out and throw it from you. And so forth. It's better to lose one of the parts of your body than for your whole body to go into hell. Like I quoted earlier, do not fear those who kill the body but are unable to kill the soul. Rather fear him who is able to destroy both soul and body in hell. These verses are in the Bible for a reason. Woe to you, scribes and Pharisees, hypocrites, because you travel around on sea and land to make one proselyte, and when he becomes one, you make him twice as much a son of hell as yourselves. You serpents, you brood of vipers, how will you escape the sentence of hell? That's Jesus talking. And the tongue is a fire, the very world of iniquity. The tongue is set among our members as that which defiles the entire body and sets on fire the course of your life and is set on fire by hell. If God didn't spare angels when they sinned but cast them into hell and committed them to pits of darkness reserved for judgment, how will he not also judge us? Universalism is gaining traction in the church. Wow, the kid's in hell. But it's real. And at least 100,000 people, as far as I know, are going there every day. Now here's one of the things to contemplate in the Christian life. How is it possible to be thrilled with God, so happy you don't know what to do with yourself, and realize your neighbor is going to spend an eternity in hell? How is that possible to handle both of those at the same time? What are we supposed to do? Are we supposed to laugh or cry? If you've ever been to my wife Heidi's conference meetings, you know that most people end up really sobbing their guts out for missions. How do you combine that with the joy of the Lord? In fact, when we're in heaven, how are we supposed to handle and enjoy heaven knowing how many people are in hell at the same time? Preaching about heaven and hell has so minimized now in the church, even in the charismatic world, that
motive for missions is nearly gone.
Motive for missions is nearly gone.
It really is. The E word has nearly disappeared. We've been so swamped by being so enamored by favor and blessing and provision and authority and climbing mountains and taking dominion and everything that making people feel better about themselves and lifting them up and teaching them to take ownership of their life and make something out of themselves and, you know, steer the direction of the world and fix the world.
Steer the direction of the world and fix the world.
That the whole subject of the next life and judgment and hell and heaven are just bypassed, largely bypassed. Now, the Lutheran Church has all the correct doctrines here. But just as I said, it's not common for the average Christian to have the ability to appreciate God very much. So also the average Christian doesn't have the ability to be concerned about the lost. Yeah, there's people. Yeah, they're not saved. Yeah, it's too bad. Yeah, I know most of the world's lost.
Yeah, I know most of the world's lost.
It doesn't affect my life. It doesn't have anything to do with me. Well, both these things are extraordinary. We're in the middle. That's what is called lukewarmness. You're not thrilled about God, and you're not so concerned that people just don't get him at all. You're just not concerned. You're just somewhere in the middle. Neither thrilled nor grieved. Just going to church. Just going to church. Just going through the motions. How many of you, when just walking down the street, you just watch somebody come the other direction and you wonder in your heart, is that person hellbound? To even ask the question. It's extraordinary. You turn on the television and all the commentators are talking about world events and all the entertainment is there and we have all these movies about all sorts of situations in life and nobody seems the least bit concerned about eternity. We're just going to put it off. And so missions becomes kind of an afterthought. You know, once a year we might have a missions convention and, you know, the missionary might come and we'll speak for a week and we'll pledge something to him. Maybe send a check once in a while. Maybe go on a short-term mission trip for 2 weeks. But otherwise, it's back to our family, back to our job, back to our community. That's our whole world. Well, we talk about joining and getting into a renewal. Well, if a renewal doesn't include the heart of the good shepherd who leaves the 99 who are comfortable back in the your own place and does anything and everything necessary and possible to go out and find that last 100th sheep that's lost out in the mountain in the cold, then we really don't have renewal. I don't call that renewal. That's just playing games. And my grandfather was an example of somebody who literally read the Great Commission and just obeyed it. He was born in Ohio, devout parents. But he read the Great Commission and he literally went to the uttermost parts of the earth. He literally took a slow boat to China, pulled by coolies up the Yangtze River Gorge, got on yakbacks and footpaths, journeyed months into the mountains, carrying my one-year-old father. My grandmother was carried in a Chinese chair by coolies. And they journeyed months further, high into the mountains, over 15,000-foot passes to the remotest corner of Tibet, just to find that last sheep. Just that last sheep. that last sheep. He went to the most forgotten, the most abandoned, the most unimportant, the least influential, the most unlikely people to ever amount to anything or have any effect on the world ever. Abandoned, diseased, beggar children in the streets. In the farthest corner of old China, which is like the Wild West in America, with no law and order, just bandits and gangs, cobblestone streets and horses and violent and poor, beggars and lepers and on all sides, bandits fighting each other all the time. My 15-year-old father at the time watched bandits execute each other and carry their heads around on pikes. Extremely violent and lawless. And they found beggar children in the streets, in rags. And it was on those beggar children that God poured out the most extensive, detailed revelations and visions on a large group of people that I have ever heard of in all of church history. Are you interested enough in God for something like that? How interested are you in him? What do you fill your life with? What is it that you really talk about when you get home with your friends and family? What sort of programs do you watch on TV? What kind of books do you read? What kind of music do you listen to? What do you do with your time? What do you really care about? All right, now here's something. You want to get into the renewal, right? And you want revival, right? Well, how does God start revival? What's God's approach? We didn't have an approach when we went to Mozambique. Back before we went, I was in San Francisco one time. Heidi and I were driving around with a local pastor. And he asked us, he said, when you get to Africa, what's going to be your strategy? And half facetiously, I wasn't too serious. I said, well, I think we'll begin by raising the dead. What actually happened was that we began raising the dead. Could we plan that? Not on your life. What did God do? He prepared Mozambique, for one thing, for revival, by giving them 500 years of slavery, colonialism, and then the worst natural disasters in history. We had three cyclones, hurricanes come together. It rained torrentially for 40 days and 40 nights, the newspaper said. Experienced the worst flooding in written history in the whole world. Whole provinces were washed out to sea. Caused more damage in 1 month than 30 years of war. We had communism. So much communism, we destroyed the Pearl of Africa until it became the poorest country in the world. Nearly every building was blown out, roof gone, no traffic on the streets, nothing in the stores. Half the children died before they were five. Rats crawling out of pipes. Nothing to buy in the stores. Our biggest request our first year there was for coffins. So many children died. Most of the coffins were small. They were just stacked up. And people didn't have money even to buy a rough pine coffin. We bought more coffins than anything else. Then the people are hungry. We went to refugee camps in the pouring rain during the floods. The people yelled at us in the pouring rain. They said, take your bread home. Take your food trucks home. We want God. We want pastors. We want Bibles. They tore us apart to get at our tracks. A cry for God went up all over the country like we've never heard of in our lives.
signs and wonders began to explode. People began to get, raised from the dead all over the place. No roads you could drive on, so we got an airplane. I tried to drive once and about destroyed our truck. Heidi said, God's going to give us a plane. 3 days later, I got a phone call. It says, money's in the bank. Go buy one. So I did. And I preached the gospel. People preach differently when they know they're going to die the next day. I remember reading a history book on preaching during the Great Plague of London. Everybody is dying of bubonic plague. The people were dying and the preachers were dying. I'm telling you, when you listen to preaching by a dying man preaching to dying people, it sounds different. It sounds completely different. Nobody's talking about dominion theology and taking over and politics and business and prosperity. They're dying the next day. So are we, soon enough. Soon enough, everybody in this room is going to be dead. That's what should concern us. That's what we should care about. And we should care about everybody else who's dying, too. Where are they going? That is far more important than business and politics and leadership and psychology and family counseling and everything else you can think of. It's not renewal if you're just sitting here to have a good time. It's not renewal because you got some spiritual gifts. It's not renewal because you got knocked down. It's only renewal when you get to know God, how He thinks, how He feels. Become His friend. Care about the things He cares about. You see the whole world the way He sees it. And you give yourself to Him. You don't take ownership of your life. You bought at a price. You're not your own anymore. I was supposed to be dead about 6-7 years ago. Doctors gave me 2 weeks to live. Stayed home in Adelaide. But every second is borrowed time, a gift from God. My life is not mine. I'm not here for me. God is not here for you. We are here for Him. He is greedy. He wants our affection. He's jealous. He is emotional. He's the most emotional person in the universe. The most romantic person in the universe. And He is very, 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 very greedy for us and our affection. And if you don't want Him, you don't have to have Him. Nobody's going to drag you into heaven if you don't want to be there. But God wants people around Him who enjoy Him, who are interested in Him, who truly love Him, to such an extent that they have lost their love for this world and everything in it. No competition from anything in this world. They have lost. They do not love their lives unto death. First Peter was written to scattered Christians being persecuted, many fed to lions. He's writing to people that may be fed to lions the next day. And He says, don't be surprised. For a short time, for a little while, you may have to endure certain things. But they have come so that your faith, more precious than gold, may be found to be genuine. For though you do not see Him, you believe in Him and are filled with inexpressible joy for you obtaining the goal of your faith, the salvation of your souls. Well, Lutherans are concerned about salvation of souls. They have good doctrine. But what I'm talking about is what only the Holy Spirit can give you. And that is the ability to appreciate God the way He wants to be appreciated. To appreciate sound doctrine the way it should be appreciated. You may know about hell and believe in hell, but are you horrified enough by it? Only the Holy Spirit can give that to you. When the Holy Spirit really fills you, you are electrified. You come alive because every aspect of truth and doctrine becomes living in you. Scripture's like a marriage manual. You can study all about marriage, but guess what? You need to be married. You can be an expert. You can quote chapter and verse of a marriage manual. You can study it. You can teach it. You can be a psychologist. You can be trained in it. But if you're not married, what's the point? That's what doctrine is to me. It's a marriage manual. But you need to be married. It's like having a cookbook. All these fantastic recipes that you actually need to cook. What good does a cookbook do sitting on the shelf, even if you've memorized it? It's like a map. But what's a map if you don't go anywhere? It's like a love letter from a girlfriend far away across the ocean, but it's not the girl. You see the point? Scripture says God is love. But we underestimate what that love is like. What I'm trying to tell you today is that there's no limit to how much love the Holy Spirit can put in you for God and each other. There's just no limit. So when I ask, are you hungry? It's not just, this is not enough. I need something more. Well, let's be more specific. Of course we need something more, but let's be very specific. You need to be more in love with Jesus. I don't mean just a little bit. I mean a whole lot. And I found out from being raised in Asia, born in China, I found out what Christians could be like under severe persecution. My father started a Bible school in Kunming, where I was born. After 2 years, the Communist Revolution took place. His assistant pastor was sent to prison. His wife was sent to another prison. They didn't see each other for 22 years. And I met them after the 22 years. By the end of that time, this pastor was head of the prison, like Joseph. And the government itself appointed him head of the Three Self Church in his entire province later. And his wife came back, and they became extremely powerful in the province. You may wonder what happened to my grandfather's kids in Visions Beyond the Veil. Two-thirds of them were martyred. The fiery ones. The bold ones. The strong ones. The wimps became the pillars of the church. They went around to the minority tribes in the high mountains. Itinerated, speaking 8 hours a day, climbing high mountains every day to get to the next village, and just preaching and teaching nonstop for years when there were no missionaries. Nobody could stop them. It was the same in Mozambique. We didn't tell pastors to go out and start churches. We didn't have a training program. We didn't have a method to start churches. You walked into a village, find the deaf person or the blind person. They get healed. The whole village knows, knew them their whole life. The chief grabs the phone, says, nobody can do this but God. We're all going to be Christians now. And all the people go, yes. Another village, on to the next. Pastors get excited. Man, in the early days, you couldn't stop them. They're barefoot. They're hungry. When we have conferences there, we send out runners into the bush because there's no internet, there's no phones, there's no mail, there's no anything. We send runners out for months in advance and say, Jesus is going to be at a certain spot 2 months from now.
Jesus is going to be at a certain spot 2 months from now.
They don't care who you are. They don't care what denomination you're from. They never heard of you. They don't care who you are. They just know Jesus is coming. And then they come. They walk barefoot. In the flood times, they walk through waist-deep mud barefoot with no food, starving, hungry, cold, because Jesus is in town. Remember one time in Martabeo on the Zambezi River, there was pouring rain. There was a lady there who was lame and blind. Husband gave up on her, left her. Jesus healed her. The word spread all over the countryside in the floods, and all day long people poured in, wading through thick mud. And that night, 10,000 people gathered in pouring rain to hear the gospel because of that one healing. And signs and wonders just kept popping off. But if those signs and wonders don't bring you to Jesus and don't get you interested in him, of what use are they? We don't preach signs and wonders. We don't chase signs and wonders. They chase us. We can't get rid of them. It's a problem. I'm telling you the truth. We don't emphasize charismatic gifts. We don't spend our time arguing with cessationists. We don't make the miracles of God the chief subject. We don't spend our time defending and arguing. We let them speak for themselves. We point people to Jesus and the cross. We say, we don't know anything but Jesus and him crucified. I don't want to let, like Paul said, let anything distract you from the simplicity and purity of devotion to Christ. Jesus is the point. He's the reason. He's our motivation. He's whom we proclaim. And so we ask, what is the gospel? Here we are, missionaries, deep in darkest Africa. What do we say to the people? We have visiting speakers. We have a lot of people coming on teams. Many of them will come into a poor village and say, I would like to preach the gospel to you. God can make it rain. He can grow your crops. He can heal your children. He can make you rich. What a wonderful God we have. But is that the gospel? Is that the impression we want to create? Is that what we want people's minds fixed on? Of course we need God to make it rain. It happens. We had droughts, ground cracked, no rain in 6 months. All the maize just withered. Come into a village. They haven't eaten anything and been able to grow anything in 6 months. Can your God make it rain? Our revival team says, of course he can make it rain. Next thing you know, there's a huge thunderstorm. That happened one day. I was flying back in my airplane from South Africa, and I noticed a huge thundercloud. I found out from our revival team the next day, that was them praying. hadn't had any clouds or rain in there in 6 months, and all of a sudden it poured rain. But that's not what we emphasize. That's not the gospel. The gospel, as Paul explained it, of first importance, as he put it, was the fact it was the life, the death, the burial, and the resurrection of Jesus. That's what we announce. That's what we preach. That is the gospel. That is what gives us hope. That's what we proclaim. It's because that actually happened in history that we have salvation. We have hope. We have direction. We have a Savior. We have something to preach. We have forgiveness of sins. We have somebody able to take away our sins.
We have somebody able to take away our sins.
As the angel explained to Joseph when he was worried about his wife bearing Jesus, angel explained, he will save his people from their sins.
He will save his people from their sins.
That is still, renewal or no renewal, tongues or no tongues, spiritual gifts or no spiritual gifts, that is the critical thing. We have somebody that can set us free from our sins.
Somebody that can set us free from our sins.
Why is the world poor? Why is it broken down? Why is there such suffering? It's all because of sin. That's the problem, not lack of education, not poor health, not all these other things. If there was one thing you could ask from God, what would it be?
If there was one thing you could ask from God, what would it be? One thing you could ask
from God. Just one thing.
Just one thing.
What if you could only ask one thing, what would you ask?
What if you could only ask one thing, what would you ask? What if you could only ask one thing?
David says, 27:4 in Psalms, one thing I ask from the Lord, this only do I seek. That I may dwell in the house of the Lord all the days of my life, to gaze on the beauty of the Lord and to seek him in his temple. That's how interested David was in his God. That was his one request. That's renewal. That's revival. I want to find people who are actually interested in God, who want to talk about him. God is never out of their thoughts. He's never disconnected. They always want to know more. They always want to know him better. They always are more. They get even more interested as the days go by. Tell me about God. God, reveal yourself. I want to know you. When my wife Heidi was 5 years old,
my wife Heidi,
she just lay on her bed at night and said, "Oh God, where are you? I just want to know you." Her sister was born 11 months later, and she could care less. Thought Heidi was crazy. 5 years old. Oh God, you're all I care about. I just want to know you. Where to find people like that? There's a verse in 73 that I have come to treasure. Yet I am always with you. You hold me by my right hand. You guide me with your counsel, and afterward you will take me into glory. Whom have I in heaven but you? And earth has nothing I desire besides you. My flesh and my heart may fail, but God is the strength of my heart and my portion forever. Okay, now you can read that verse and you can agree with it.
Now you can read that verse and you can agree with it.
But it's the Holy Spirit that makes you feel like the writer of that felt.
Makes you feel like the writer of that felt.
See what I'm saying? It's the Holy Spirit that gives you love for God and people.
That gives you love for God.
Honestly, you can speak in tongues and not have that kind of love for God
and
people.
Not have that kind of love for God.
You can fall down and shake and vibrate on the floor and not have that.
Shake and vibrate on the floor and not have that.
It should help. Very gracious of God to show up and manifest himself. But you should respond to that.
You should respond to that.
Not treat it lightly. I know people that have been super wrecked, but when I get near them, they go, "Oh no, not now, not now. I don't want that anymore.
Go, oh, no, let's see. Now,
don't touch me. Just stay away."
Don't touch me. Just stay away.
I'm busy.
I'm busy. Now you might say, okay, I get the point. I should just drop everything and seek God. But actually, I have a job. I have bills to pay. I'm in school. I have practical needs. I actually have to feed myself and, you know, pay for a car. I have responsibilities. I have to raise my children. How am I supposed to just drop everything? Can you picture the disciples? You know, Jesus is walking by the Sea of Galilee, and they're mending their nets, and he just says, follow me. And they drop their nets, and they just follow him. I wonder what their families thought. Well, first of all, I'm telling you, if Jesus really is calling you, and the Holy Spirit really is calling you to drop everything, your kids will be all right. So will your bills. We get accused all the time of being so heavenly minded, we're no earthly good. We're just irresponsible. But if everybody sought God like David did here, on the leading of the Holy Spirit, the world would be okay. You would be provided for. You wouldn't have to worry about anything. Jesus multiplied fish once, twice. He's done it. He's multiplied bread and lousy, cold, sticky spaghetti a number of times. I thought he was a better cook than that. But he makes it just like we did. One time when the communists ejected us out of our property and we suddenly had 300 orphans to feed and nowhere to live and no food and no money. We just had a little flat in the city. It was just crowded with kids and urine was running down the hall and we were just hosing off everybody and everybody's starving. A Christian lady from the U.S. Embassy came over with a bowl of chili beans for Heidi and me and our two kids. And Heidi said, yeah, but we have a lot of kids. Just pray over the food. Her name was Nelda. Nelda said, no, don't make me do that. It's just too embarrassing. That's ridiculous. We made her pray over the food, and all everybody ate. Everybody ate. But you have to be very childlike, totally abandoned, totally obedient, totally submissive. Jesus is all that matters to you, and that's it. End of subject. Full stop. I'm going to continue later about this marriage we have with God. A lot of people don't think God is romantic. But God describes himself to the nation of Israel as their husband over and over. He is our husband, not just our father. He's everything we need. He's an infinite, invisible God that we cannot see as the Father. But the Father also manifested himself as a Son. Colossians says, the fullness of the deity dwelt in bodily form. He's also a perfect companion. He's also Holy Spirit that can be everywhere. He's just absolutely perfect. He comes to us in with these various perspectives because he's perfect. But I know in my own heart that he is the only thing there is in the universe that satisfies what our hearts are created for and need. We need romance. We absolutely need romance. When we have that, that's what produces incredible joy. That's what the Christian life is about. You can agree with that. You can sit here and nod and say, yep, that's true. That doesn't mean you have much of it. And I would like tonight for you to get a whole lot more of it by the power of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Let's go have dinner.
announcements. I have no idea how it works now. Mark. It's all done. It's all done. Super organized.